している保管課。練習場に連れて行ったところ、エリーちゃんが自分から登ろうとしたので、下から安全を確保し、
Hey everyone, Charlie here, and welcome to another episode of One Cuppa Japan. Hope you're all doing well. Before we get started in this episode, I want to preface everything that I may say by saying that any complaints that I may have in response to the questions that you're in response to your questions that this episode will actually be built upon today, let's go this way, should be put into context. As I'm sure many, if not all of you, are aware, the past 4 or 5 days have been really, really, really bad for many people here in Japan, particularly in the Kyushu region, Kumamoto, where a staggering number of earthquakes have left people dead, have destroyed many others' homes, left many other people injured. I just ask that we keep all of this right. Everything I say today will be ultimately inconsequential in the grand scheme of things, so let's keep that in mind. If any of you out there are interested, check out these beautiful flowers. Right, it's important, I think, in these situations to appreciate the beauty of life. It's impermanence. Those are going to be gone in a number of weeks. But anyway, if any of you are interested in getting involved in the recovery, rescue, etc. efforts that are going on now for the residents of Kumamoto in Kyushu, you can, of course, go through the Japanese Red Cross, and I will certainly be putting that information in the description below the video. So, now that we've gotten that super important bit out of the way, let's get to it, shall we? So, as you may have noticed, I took about the last week, almost 2 weeks off from YouTube. To be honest, I felt a little burnt out, not particularly on YouTube, but I felt burnt out just in general. This is something I talk about more over on the collaboration channel with Wikipedia, the Borough, but, most of my time is spent in sort of this creative process, and, just like anything else, if you spend too much time on it, it burns you out. So, sort of on like this creative cool down period, where I just needed to sort of take a step back from the internet, take a step back from writing, and just sort of chill. So that's where I've been. Last weekend, let's take a look at this before we continue. This is just, and I need to start my watch because I'm gonna start the timer on my watch, rather, because I'm definitely gonna be keeping this below 45 minutes today, just for the sake of making it easier for you guys to stand, and a little bit easier for me to edit and process. But yeah, now that it is officially spring here, right, cherry blossom season has passed us. It smells like cow poop. It smells like cow poop out here, because the farmers are now getting the fields ready for to take the rice, right? So last weekend I went to Osaka, and I met with Wikipedia, and I met with Nippon Culture Quest, met with Hide in Osaka, Pickles to Gaijin. I really hope I'm not going to forget anybody, but I feel like there's definitely somebody I'm forgetting right now. Anyway, I met with a lot of cool YouTubers, really cool to meet people. And I had never met Emily of Wikipedia in person before, although she and I, like I said, we run that collab channel together. And I had I had sort of gone on about how excited I was to get her on what would be, I guess, this episode, effectively, of One Cuppa. But I'm sad to say it just didn't work out. The time we had between meeting with other people and her responsibilities to to the people she was traveling with and things like that. It just didn't work out to shoot on one couple with her, but I hope to rectify that sometime in the future. But anyway, she is a fantastic human being. Had a lot of fun talking to her and going to karaoke with her and everything like that. So please, please, please be sure to check out her YouTube channel and support a really awesome person. So without further ado, now that we're 5+ minutes into this, probably, I wanted to build this episode a little differently, which is why on my Facebook and Twitter pages/accounts, however best to put it, I asked for your guys' questions or suggestions for topics. So that's what we're really going to dig into today. Like I said, we're really trying to sort of keep these one cuppas to a respectable time frame. So I'm going to get to as many of your questions as I can. And of course, you guys can always send me questions, concerns, queries, whatever, that I can help ameliorate. And any email on YouTube, whatever the case may be, and I'll do my best to respond to them in an intelligent way. So the first question comes to us from Raz Al Ghul, and I apologize. I have a couple questions saved in my memory bank, so to speak, in my head, but I'm going to have to stop every now and then to look at my phone to check out the questions you guys asked me, so that's going to interrupt our flow here a little bit. I wonder if I can go up here. One thing you notice is how verdant it suddenly is. Like, the weeds have just exploded, and with them comes bugs, right? So you'll notice me walking through clouds of bugs, and yes, fucking spider webs. So, like I said, our first question today comes from our friend Raz Al Ghul, all the way from London, asking, what is the thing that I learned about myself? What is the most important thing that I've learned about myself since coming to Japan? And I think for me it's that it's okay to be myself. And I know how trite that sounds, right? Like, that's like fortune cookie wisdom you give to your... Now check this out, sorry. But yeah, that's like fortune cookie wisdom, right? Like, you give to your kid when your kid has a bad day and people are picking on them when they go to school, and you're like, listen, Tammy, or whatever your kid's name may be, right? Like, you're just like, it's absolutely okay to be yourself, and if other kids don't understand, then screw them. But I mean, that's really what it is, right? And that's how I feel here, is that of course, like, one of the big reasons I stand out, right, is because I look different from everybody. I'm a little bit chubbier. You know, different parts of my body have different shapes than the locals here and everything like that, which is fine. And of course, I stand out for that reason, but my weirdness, both physically and philosophically and as far as my hobbies go and everything like that, is what makes people, it's what gets and keeps people interested in me, right? Sorry, there's just a Jeep going by here, I'm waiting for. That's what makes me interesting, right? And I don't know, for whatever reason, when I was still living in the States, my differences made me feel really self-conscious, which is weird in a way, right? Because there's this that old saying about Japan where, you know, the nail that sticks out gets hammered down. I don't feel that way here versus in America, where individuality is everything, where people who are weird are different. That's all you ever hear about is how weird or different or undesirable those kind of people are, right? And I am in my own ways one of those kind of people. So I think that's the long-winded way of saying that, yeah, I learned that it's okay to be my weird, flawed self here and stand out for the things that make me me. Our second question, and this is the second one that I've sort of kept in my memory, and the last one Anyway, it comes to us from Lucas Muser, also another longtime friend. There's a couple of girls going to there's a couple of girls over here just like hanging out on like a seesaw who are like looking at me, and we had a moment of nodding. But anyway, Lucas asks if I've taken up any martial arts and I've been here now. This is something Hide slash Sam of Hide in Osaka asked me over this delicious okonomiyaki slash yakisoba last weekend, was whether I've taken up any martial arts again since I've been here. I was into Iaido for a long time when I was in the States, but there's not an Iaido dojo here. An Iaido school in like a relatively close by area. Sorry to stop, but no, I'm not sorry to stop. It's beautiful, right? This is the transformation of the season, and I've shown this before, but this is one of my favorite areas. It's relatively close to my house. I love these little tunnels. They feel like, I don't know, they feel like these really, they tend to serve like this really important purpose in my fiction writing, because I always think of them as like these, like spirited away, right? Like I think of them as these pathways to these other world type things. So I really love, really, really love areas like this. But anyway, to answer the question at hand, I haven't taken up any martial arts since I've been back here. Not seriously, anyway. I will occasionally go to a couple of community centers to do some judo or karate. But other than that, nothing seriously inconsistent. However, probably within the next couple of weeks, I will be taking up kudo, archery, traditional archery here, twice a week. So I'm really, really looking forward to that. Always wanted to get into archery, but unless you're looking to kill shit in the United States, there's no like big thing for archery, at least where I grew up. So good question. And I'm sure once I get into that, I'll be making a video about what that experience is actually like. So let's take a look at our next question here. And sorry again, guys, for having to look at my phone. All right, now the next question comes to us from Jacob Foster on our Facebook page. Multi-part question. What lesson were you most proud of at school? What in Japan makes you the happiest? And which part of the Japanese language have you struggled with the most? What lesson plan was I most happy with? That's a good question. Like, I realize maybe I should have thought about these a little bit more beforehand, but I wanted my answers to be sort of off the cuff. So, lesson plan I'm most happy with. Lesson plan I'm happiest with, excuse me. There's a sneeze coming on because one of those little bastard gnats flew up my nostril. And it's tickling the inside of my nose, and I don't want to kill it, but I should. And you mentioned too the constellation lesson plan I had done for a special lesson. That one was really, really big for me, although it didn't go very well, to be honest. Okay, so there was, now I've used this kind of lesson plan. Check this out, guys. This sort of overgrown brush, right, and this stone walkway leading up to a higher part. Why don't we walk up there, right? We've walked this other way 100 times. I literally don't think I've ever taken this pathway up to the higher road before, this particular one, but you can see these boulders stacked on top of each other to form this sort of wall and support for some of the houses that are up there. But as for the lesson plans, there's this one I will do every now and then where basically after you introduce the language, right, like whatever it may be, like what are you doing, or are you hungry, what do you want to eat, I want a pancake, right, I want anything, right? And so what you do at the sort of the climax of that part of the lesson is you put a couple of chairs together, and effectively you form a train in your classroom, right? And you hand out little tickets, and you take turns playing conductor with your kids, and you use a hole punch, and you practice the language, and it just always is so, God, I love how well it goes every time. and how much the kids love it, because kids love trains here, right, in a way that they don't in the States, because we don't have that as sort of a built-in part of our culture anymore, the trains, right, public transportation. But kids here, they aspire to be train drivers, they aspire to be, you know, attendants on trains, engineers, things like that. So, I apologize, I've forgotten the other two parts of the question. So that is the first part. What in Japan makes you the happiest? And what are the parts of the Japanese language that I struggle with the most? So I'm going to answer these questions as though they were one, because... Oh! Konnichiwa! I'll be right back. I'm going to go talk to my friend here. Okay, so I've just met one of my friends who I drink with regularly at the izakaya that I talk about all the time. Just met his daughter and his granddaughter. Wow. For the first time. That's really, really cool. It's one of the benefits of doing these sort of walk and talks, right? Anyhow, what was I talking about? Oh, so the things that make me happiest about living in Japan and the things that I struggle with the most, right? And we need to start this back up again, don't we? You've just, no, well, not so much seen for the sake of their privacy, but we've just been interrupted by the thing that makes me happiest, which is people, you know. And of course, that would be, the answer to that question is the same if I was still living in America. The things that make me happiest, that made me happiest about living in America, were the people. My family, my friends, my dog, my cat, you know, all those people. Those are the things that make me the happiest here too, these relationships. And oh my God, I don't know if this has the same sort of majesty, right, as it does for me seeing it through my own eyes, but just how green it is, the hills, and it's so humid, and it's hot today, and it was so, so windy, like, I literally witnessed Benja literally witnessed a woman catching her dog earlier because it was so windy and it blew the freaking dog away, you know what I mean? Like, but anyway, yeah, that's the thing that makes me the happiest, and the things that are most difficult for me about the Japanese language are, I think probably words with, when a dictionary defines many words as having the same meaning, right, but there's so much nuance to different words. So let's think, so let me see if I can think of a good example off the top of my head. And show you my overview of the, I forget what this sport is called, but anyway, here's a sports field, there's the Sabai Library and Cultural Center, and mountains. Okay, so this is the one that happened to me recently, right, is the verb utsuru, which means to sort of, to be moved or transfer, and the verb hikosu, right? So I'm trying to move, I'm not sure if it's going to happen or not 100%, but, right, so both, if you look at a dictionary, have this connotation of moving, as in moving a house, right, or transferring. Now, in the case of utsuru, right, utsuru has this sort of nuance where you're sort of transferring within the same company, right? So if I were transferring to a new job within the school system that I work for now, that would be utsuru, right? Whereas, and same thing too, if I were moving to another Leo Palace apartment, utsuru. But if I were moving, which I plan to a completely new apartment or a new home or something like that, outside of Leo Palace or whatever, hikosu, right? And so that's just one example of sort of this nuance, which particularly if you're doing a lot of your study from the book, you don't really understand until you're in a conversation with somebody and you're wondering why you're using like hikosu versus utsuru, and they keep spinning the other, like the opposite verb that you think you should be using back at you, like why you should be using one and not the other. So it makes for some embarrassment And yeah, but I mean, to be honest, the whole process of learning a language is just this constant series of embarrassments and feeling like you're not good enough and everything else like that. So, oh, this is awesome, by the way. We are in this park we haven't been in for a long time. This is, well, now I suppose about 10, 15 minutes. 10 minutes if we're walking straight from my apartment. You can see now the vines climbing up on the trees, and the azalea are now in bloom. Well, starting to bloom anyway over this trellis. For those of you who've been around the channel for a while, you may recognize this from the Great Sabai Curry Hunt video, where this thing is just infested with bees over the summertime because there are so many flowers up there. But let's get back to the questions, right? That's the important part of this episode, of course. So, pardon me again while I look at my phone. One of the things is that my friend who I just met asked me. He was like, "You're already drinking?" Because I have a strong zero in my hand. For you guys. Or so I'll pretend. Is there anywhere else you want to live besides Japan? What is your single favorite place to be? This comes to us from Posime, who is just a beautiful human. And I don't mean that from her physical appearance, although she is certainly physically beautiful, of course, but she's just a really, really kind person who has really been supportive of me since I started a YouTube channel here. Is there anywhere else I want to live besides Japan? What is my single favorite place to be? I don't know that there's any other place I would like to live besides Japan besides a cabin in the woods in Western New York. Just because I haven't spent enough time other places, maybe Montreal, because I really, really love, love, love Montreal. So maybe that answers both parts of that question. I would love to live in Kyoto, actually. But that's not exactly someplace other than Japan, is it? If it was someplace other than Japan, if I published a piece of work that was successful enough where I could live in the woods of Western New York and enjoy all the seasons, the four seasons that come with that sort of lifestyle and living off the land and everything like that, I would love to do that. And it's sort of a really timely question, but if there's one place I could define as my favorite, be in Western New York, Rochester, outside of Rochester, New York, with my parents, my uncle and aunt, and my cousins, and all of my family, around a campfire, drunk, eating shitty food that tastes so good, shitty in the sense that it's really, really bad for you, and just, you know, talking about inappropriate things and romanticizing everything that is Disney, because that's the kind of family we are. That's probably my favorite place to be, but of course, here, in this season where it smells like cow shit and flowers and the revivification of life, this is certainly up there, right? So, Posey, thank you for the question. Next, from Fabian Foghart, who is a major, major part of the Tokyo Digital crew, by the way, for those of you looking for royalty-free music for YouTube videos. I use his music a lot. He asks, "I want to know what your favorite game OST is and why." My favorite game... Wow, I think that would go for me between three things. Final Fantasy VII, Final Fantasy X, and The Last of Us. Final Fantasy VII, because it reminds me of my first big foray into video games. FF7 was everything to me, so that's important. Final Fantasy X, because that story remains really impactful for me, and that sort of leap in hardware that allowed Nobuo Uematsu to... There's my American pronunciation. Nobuo Uematsu to produce this really... complex symphonic score for it was ultimately a fantasy experience. I mean, that's why my channel trailer uses that music, right? Because it's really, really important to me. it's beautiful and it's heartbreaking and it's important. Because that game was about basically like, all right, well, you are this thing, right? Maybe you're not real, but that doesn't mean you're not important, right? So anyway, and then The Last of Us, because I am a big believer in video games being a really powerful, important tool for great storytelling, and The Last of Us is a great story. And the music in that game lends so much to the atmosphere, to that storytelling experience, that you know, I listen to it and I'm pulled back to these places of loss and gain and all these things, and it hurts and it feels good. So that's why probably The Last of Us out of everything is the best for me. Do we want to go up another? Yeah, we do. We do, right? We want to go up a little, another narrow pathway. We should watch the steps because I almost fell on my face. Look how close this is. All right. Next question, asking me to talk about thrifting/secondhand shopping here. Don't want to spend too much time on that topic, but suffice it to say that whether it is clothing, and this is a question from Who is PTD, whether it's clothing, can I get out this way? No, I can't. Well, we're gonna go this way anyway. Whether it's clothing or manga, video games, CDs, yeah. You should not find it too terribly hard to find what you're looking for here on the cheap. Although getting rid of your clothes, if you're coming here to live and you find yourself having lost, I don't know, let's just say hypothetically 60 pounds. No, that's not true. 45, 50 pounds, and you're trying to offload those clothes, then it becomes a little more difficult. Next question from Simon Haggerty. What is it like not living in Tokyo? And also, what would you change about Japan if you could? Now, I should point out that as far as my feelings about Tokyo are concerned, I don't really like Tokyo. And so having not spent like a really, really long time there, any opinions I have formed about Tokyo are almost exclusively based on this sort of confirmation bias type of thing, where I've seen things, right, confirm the opinions I have about living in Tokyo. Anyway, so in my experience, the things that are different for me about living here is that friendships are harder to come by. Because we are in the Inaka, even the foreigners you meet here, not even, the foreigners you meet here tend to cloister together. Here, mostly everybody, because the Eikaiwa presence is relatively low, even in Fukui City, mostly everybody I meet here is an ALT, and ALTs tend to clump together, which can be really good. Like, some of my very good friends here are a group of ALTs, but the problem with that is that you do have to deal with that sort of group mentality whenever you want to do anything, etc., etc. You know, and it's not just foreigners here. Like, you know, of course, I live here in Japan. I don't know what this old guy's doing, but I'm across the road. I live here in Japan, and so I should, you know, I should speak Japanese to people. I should make an effort to speak the language of the land, right? And when I go to Kyoto or Osaka or Tokyo for work training, I'm always surprised at like how, I shouldn't say eager, but how ready people are to speak English to me, just as a matter of assumption. And here, it just doesn't happen so much. Like, it's very rarely the case for me that even if somebody assumes at the konbini or grocery store that I don't speak Japanese, which is, to be honest, pretty close to a correct assumption going by my recent forays into Japanese studies. You know, But yeah, it just doesn't happen so much here, so there's not... As far as forming relationships with Japanese people, there needs to be that extra effort here, which I feel like necessarily, and I want you to remember I use that word necessarily, you don't need to have that knowledge of Japanese that you need to have here if you want to make really strong bonds, really actual meaningful relationships with Japanese people. So I hope, Simon, I've answered both of your questions. I'm going to check on the phone here to check our next question to make sure I have. What would I change about Japan? I don't know. Like most people, I'm sort of a walking bundle of contradictions, right? Now check this out, guys. Here's one of those fields I was talking about. As I just walked through a freaking spider web, and I just set up on these sort of like different levels, right? And yeah, this is all going to be turned into rice fields here pretty shortly. And then it will be harvested in October. But as for what I would change about Japan, you know, on the one hand, I don't believe in cultural relativity. I believe it's like, it's the best we have for now, but I think there's sort of like a universal morality and everything like that, which we just haven't sort of stumbled upon just what that is yet. Easy to say, right? But at the same time, I'm also really sort of hesitant to sort of say, well, this is how things should be in one place or the other. Or, you know, anything like that. So, that being said, if I could change one thing about Japan, fucking hell, maybe it would be to get rid of all the spider webs, I don't know. But other than that, it would be to say, I wish it was more open to the international world. Of course, there are a lot of foreigners here now, there are a lot of international ideas, but there is still this sort of prevailing idea of being special, right? And of course, Japanese culture, Japanese people in their own way, like many, 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 all cultures have things that are special and unique and wonderful about them, things that should be protected and preserved. But I feel like there's actually a spider in my face. But there is sort of this feeling sometimes where it's like, well, it's Japanese, so it's sort of infallible, you know? So, I guess that's all I really say about that. But yeah, I would just guess to say that I feel it was a little less xenophobic. But that comes with time, right? And you have to remember that as of 140-ish years ago, this was still completely closed off to the rest of the world, right? And sometimes that sort of progress, and that in itself is a loaded word, takes time. Takes time, right? So, anyway, as we're nearing the end of this cuppa, let's attempt our final questions here from Granny, who, as I recall, is a fellow from France, so this should be cool to get his questions. A foreigner can only vote to local elections in Japan. Since it became your home, do you wish to get more involved? Secondly, what's a question no one asks you but you think is an important topic to talk about, and what are your thoughts about it? As for politics, yes, I would love to be more involved. Right now I'm sort of limited to, like, for example, this coming week, we're going to be holding like a kind of like a fundraiser for the people in Kumamoto, not a barbecue, kind of like a luncheon type thing. Like everybody brings a dish to pass, and if you come, then you donate like 500 yen or whatever type of thing. So I like to get involved in that way. But as for the voting process, I have to admit that I'm not educated enough on the Japanese governmental system just yet to to be able to make an educated vote. That's just the way it is. Although, if we were to take, if we were to put Japanese pilot, politics into the frame of American politics, I would of course probably vote more on the left side of things, where, you know, yeah, I would certainly like to see this country be more progressive. So I guess that's all I really say about that, because I don't ever want this to be like a political pissing contest channel. So the last question there, also from Granny, is there one question that I really want to answer that I haven't been asked yet? As we're nearing the end of our cuppa, is there one question that I haven't been asked that I wish somebody would ask me? I don't know, it's one of those things. It's almost like that question, like the hardest thing about Japanese, right? Like, I'm sure, and I know that I've thought about this on many occasions, like I wish, particularly when I was doing like my live streams and trying to get people on, is that I was always wishing, like, I was like, you know, I wish people would have me on their channels or their live streams to ask me questions, because I have a story I want to tell too. I don't feel that way so much now, because I don't know, like that was part of like, it was an ego thing, which I don't really possess all that much anymore, I guess. But you know, I guess anything, this is really going to be general because I can't think of a specific question, but just really any questions that have to do with my personal experience, you know, like most of the questions I get are like, what is X like in Japan, which isn't about me at all. You know, it's about like, it's about education or society. Konnichiwa. You know, it's about those systems I'm being asked about, or the culture I'm being asked about. So of course, I don't know, but you know, I could talk about, go on like that for a while and never really give you an answer to that question. So I guess for now, I'll have to leave it at that. The fact is that, I don't know, particularly that I run this series where usually I'm just talking about whatever comes to mind. You know, there's never a time where I'm like, oh, I don't feel like I have an outlet to talk about the things I want to talk about, because clearly I have had given myself too much time to talk about these different things, as was the case with the last episode, which was nearly an hour. Never happening again. Never. But yeah guys, on that note, thanks as always for watching. Let's finish up our cuppa here. It's warm, so it's, and it's budget too high. So of course, I really, really like the idea of building these one cuppas on your questions, on certain topics that you want to hear talked about versus just things that come to my mind, although I like that format too. So of course, if you have other questions you want answered that I didn't address in this episode, or if I failed to address a question that you already asked, as we walk past what I still think to be really beautiful. Rice fields are really beautiful no matter what the season, I think. Even if it is just basically a giant square of cow shit and weeds. Yeah, you know, of course, always let me know. I always want to get in touch with you guys whatever way I can. And on that note, I guess I just have to say thank you as always for watching, guys. Thank you for your support. And as we show you the slope of blooming multicolored flowers, we'll leave you at that and we'll say cheers.